Hello. I struggled to understand Tokio for quite a while because there are a couple of things that the documentation tries really hard not to explain. This is the first one. The runtime is responsible for repeatedly calling poll on a future until its value is returned. This makes me really anxious. Is Tokio going to poll my future every second? Which means, like, if it finishes earlier than that, there's going to be really high latency. Or will it poll every millisecond, which means it will finish quickly, but it might use a lot of CPU. In fact, it's not actually timer-based at all, but the fact that I didn't know really bothered me. I really needed to know the answer. This is the other one. Poll implementations must never return NotReady unless they receive NotReady by calling an inner future. Hang on a minute. It can't be futures all the way down. What if I need to implement the innermost future? This is called a leaf future, by the way. It turns out in normal Tokyo code, you don't need to do this very often, which is probably why they avoid explaining it. But to me, it was a critical piece of the puzzle. I couldn't understand how all the pieces fit together until I understood that. Turns out these questions are actually closely related, and in this video, I'm going to do a brief demo to show exactly how the Tokyo executor interacts with a future, and how you can write your own leaf future. It's actually kind of straightforward, and once I understood this, I finally understood how the rest of Tokyo is layered on top. So, here's a super basic example. I'm defining a struct, my future, and I want to make it a future that you can poll as part of a Tokyo task. And I'll do that by implementing the future trait. It's going to return, this future is going to return a U32 when it finishes, and there is no particular kind of error that it can produce. So down here in the main method, I'm going to first create the future and then chain a combinator onto it, a map that will take the U32 value, print it to screen, and then not return anything. It maps it to the unit type. It's important that the overall future, all chained together, has a unit type for both the value and the error, or else the Tokyo executor won't run it for Tokyo run. So as part of my future, I need to provide a poll function. So for this example application, I am trying to understand the pattern in which poll is called. So I'm going to print a screen every single time I get a poll. So for the first time, let's say we already have a result, the number 42. So the very first time we get polled, we're going to say, hey, we're done. The answer is 42. So let's see what happens when I run this code. Okay. We created the future. We spawned it as part of a task. And we can see that it wasn't polled until after it was spawned. Futures don't do anything until they're polled for the first time. So we were polled and we returned ready result with 42. And then that closure in main said we resolved with 42 and the task was complete. Great, this is pretty much what we expect. We only had to get polled once because we had the result the first time. Now, let's make a change. What if the future never finished? What if we just returned not ready every single time it was polled? What will Tokyo do in that case? Let's find out. I'm going to change that line of code. So instead of a value, we just provide not ready. Okay, let's run that instead. Okay, our program has gotten stuck in the middle. It hasn't finished. This makes sense. Tokyo run won't return until all the spawn tasks have ended. The task won't end until the future finishes, and by design, our future will never finish. So we hang. But have a look at this. Poll has been called only once. Tokyo gave us one chance to provide a response, and we didn't have it the first time, and now it's just given up on us completely. On the bright side, it's not calling poll in an endless loop because that would use a ton of CPU, but it raises an obvious question. What happens when we do have the answer? How do we make sure that we get polled again? And the answer is that we need to trigger it. So suppose the number takes 1 second to calculate. We need to, after that second, we need to give Tokyo a hint that our future is ready to do more work. It doesn't necessarily mean that we're ready to provide a result, but we need to just say, hey, Tokyo, could you give poll another go? That would be awesome. So the way you do that is by storing a reference to the currently running Tokyo task. This is easiest to show with an example. Let's modify this code so that once per second, it will request a new poll. It will still never finish, but the overall behavior will be different. So whenever poll gets called, I want to wait 1 second. You would never write Tokio code like this, but it will do for an example. I'm going to spawn a thread which sleeps for 1 second from 6-1. Now, while the poll is running, I need to record a reference to the currently running task. I'll put that in a binding called task. Oops. Then I'll move that inside the thread closure, and when the 1 second is up, I'll call notify on it. This is the special call that tells Tokio that we need a fresh poll. You can store the task in a field if you want, but here I'm just capturing it directly into the closure. And when after we spawn it, obviously we're not ready yet, so that's what we return. So let's save that and run this version. Cancel the old one. Now, when we run it, poll is being called once per second. Each time poll gets called, it asks for a new poll 1 second later. Every single time we end up returning not ready, so we're trapped in this condition forever. So it is true that Tokio drives futures to completion by calling poll. This description glosses over the fact that the future itself is very much in control of how this polling happens, which is good. It's sort of like a hybrid push-pull model, which makes it very efficient. One thing to be careful about, there is nothing that says there won't be extra calls to poll. If that happened here, then this future would be in trouble. It would just keep requesting more and more polls and spawn more and more threads. And in this case, that's not happening. It's sort of only giving me a sensible number of threads and printing a sensible number of messages to screen. So that's good. Now I want to make this a touch more real. I want to show a leaf future that transitions from not ready to ready. The example is slightly contrived, but I've come across something a bit like this in real application code, so I'm not completely making it up. Suppose we have some library that somebody's written, which counts the number of lines in a text file, and for whatever reason we have to use this particular function. And it doesn't understand anything about Tokio or futures. It's designed to work on very large files, so instead of blocking the current thread, it internally creates its own thread to do the work. It will let us know when it finishes by executing a function or closure that we provide. So our challenge is to wrap this function in a future so that it can be used as part of a Tokio task. We want to chain a map onto it as before to say this is how many lines were in the file. So the first time it's polled, it will start counting the lines by calling this function and return not ready. At some later point, the counting will finish. Our future should request to be polled again, and this time it will return ready, along with the line count that we got through this closure. So first we have to define a struct, which is going to hold the state information for this future. We have two pieces of information. One is the path of the file whose lines we want to count. I'm going to make this an option, so when the future is first created, this will be filled in with some path. Then when we have polled the first time, we'll take that path out of the option, leaving none in its place. This means if poll gets called additional times, we won't repeat the calculation multiple times. The second piece of information is a mutex that contains the line count. This is again an option. It will start out as none, and when we receive the result from the callback, we'll fill it in with some number. It will soon become clear why this has to be inside an arc mutex. First, I'll make a new function that sets the initial state. We take the file path as a parameter. This gets stored in the first field as a sum, and our line count starts out as none, as I said, protected by a mutex. Okay, now let's implement the future. We know that the line counter function returns a use size, so that's going to be the item type. Let's make it simple and say we're not going to provide any particular type of error. This isn't realistic, of course. I could provide a path to a file that doesn't exist, in which case the poll function should return an error result. but for this example, I'm going to assume it always works. Next, I need to implement the poll function, of course. So we'll print out to screen just so we can see what's happening. If it's the first time, we will successfully take a file name out of the file name option, in which case we'll record the current task, take a reference to the result field, and call our library function with the path that we extracted, and providing a closure right here for what happens when that result is found. So when it finishes counting, we'll lock the mutex and insert the number of lines n. We'll fill it in with some value. Remember, this started out as none. And then we'll notify the task to say that we're ready for a new poll. And because we've only just started the work, this can't have finished yet. So we're going to return a not ready result immediately. We're going to wait for this to finish and this notify to get called. Now, let's consider the alternative case down here. We've been polled, but we don't have the file name. So there's two possibilities. Either the calculation is still underway or it's actually finished. We might have received an extra poll in the middle, for example. So if we have we will lock the result mutex and see if there's some value there. If it has, we're done. So we will return ready with that number of lines. And if it's not done, it means the we've been polled early effectively. So we're just going to return not ready, not do anything. And that's actually it. Finally, I get to use the future. So in main, I'll create the future, passing in a path buff to some file whose lines I want to count. And when that future completes, I will take the value and print it out to screen like I was doing before. I'll spawn the whole thing as a task before and wait for it to finish using Tokio Run. Let's run it and see how it goes. It seems to have worked. We can see there are five lines in that file that we specified. So let's look more closely at this log. It was polled the first time and it began the computation, starting the count. Then at some point, the computation finished. We entered that closure, count complete, and we notified Tokio to give us another poll. So we were polled again. This time we were ready and we were able to supply the number of lines 5. So hopefully you can see now why it was necessary to put the result inside an arc mutex. When you spawn a task, the associated futures become owned by Tokio. So this whole struct is owned by Tokio, but the calculation had its own other thread that needed to store the result in this shared field. So this is one straightforward way to share a data field, a mutable data field between threads, putting it inside an arc mutex. But it's not the only way. You can also use channels for cross-thread communication, and it points to a much simpler way to solve this problem. In reality, you don't necessarily need to create your own future for this kind of situation. Here's another way that requires much less code. First, I create a Tokio one-shot channel. The receiving end, Rx, is a future that resolves to whatever gets sent through the sending side, Tx, and this is a feature that just comes with Tokio. So I can start the computation, count lines, right here in main. And when it finishes, I'll poke the value into the sending end of the channel by using the send function. Simultaneously, I'll spawn a Tokio task that waits for the receiving end to resolve to a value, at which point I'll simply map it to a closure and again print it to screen just like before. So I can run this. And it achieves basically the same thing as before, no futures required. It's not exactly the same. There might be some reasons why you would want a real future, but in many cases, this is much simpler. So there are actually good reasons why the Tokio documentation doesn't talk too much about leaf futures. In a lot of situations, you can take advantage of IO types or channels that are provided by Tokio, which means you don't have to store the task and call notify by yourself. In the next video, I intend to rewrite the line counting example, this time using the built-in Tokio IO functionality instead of using a provided library function. The main point of this video is to show how leaf futures interact with the Tokio executor, not necessarily how to write sensible Tokio code. Cool. Until next time, cheerio.